The resurrection of Christ. Do you know in 1 Thessalonians it tells us that when Jesus comes again, his second coming, when he comes again, those who are dead in Christ will rise first, and then those who are still on the earth will be risen up to him as well. And you know, we're going to sing about that this morning, about our second coming of Christ, and when we're going to see Jesus. I don't know about you, but boy, I look forward to that day. Whether I rise from the grave or whether I just go straight up to be with him, I look forward to the day, and I give him thanks because of Easter, because of the events of Easter, that we have hope, a reason for living, and we can look forward to seeing our Savior again. We're going to sing about that this morning, so I hope you come ready to have a toe tapping and a hand clapping good time. Let's stand up as we begin. Thank you. Victory that Jesus Christ won at Easter in the resurrection is why we have a promise of heaven. And we celebrate Him this morning, and I hope you know Jesus Christ, because when you know Jesus Christ, it changes everything. It changes how you look at things on the earth. It changes how you live. It changes how you approach death. It changes your joy. It changes everything. So I hope you know Jesus Christ today. We're going to celebrate our risen Lord together. If you have not already filled out your information card, we ask everybody to do it, and then when you leave, you just drop it in the altar drop box at the back of the sanctuary, and we appreciate that so very much. Please come before the Lord this morning as we pray. Oh, Father God, as we come before you, we do get found that your word is true, your promises are secure, and as you came the first time, according to your word, you died. Rose from the dead according to your word. Your word is said that you're coming again. And we know that your word is true. You've done what you said. You will do what you said. So we seek to live for you and to worship you because you're worthy. I thank you for each one that is here today. I thank you that we have come into your presence. And as we do, we find your complete sufficiency for all of our needs and for your grace and mercy that provides for our forgiveness. Thank you.
Thank you.
Calvary, where Jesus fell and died for me, I feel you to have to be my Savior. Thank you.
Tell you what, if I can't walk home now, the home place, as it is. Psalm 22. Psalm 22. You know, the meaning of all the Bible is wonderful. But there's some passages in the Bible that just stand out as tremendous. You can probably name some of the book of Revelation, some in the Psalms. But certainly, Psalm 22 is an incredible, an amazing passage of Scripture. It speaks of the life, the birth, the life, the death, the resurrection, the reign, eternity, all in one song. So I have to hold on, but we got to go through quickly just a portion of some of the tips of the beauty of the treasure that God has for us in this passage. In Psalm 22, then you begin reading verse 1. Have your outline ready? Psalm 22 begins in verse 1. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh, my God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, and am not silent. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the praise of Israel. In you our fathers put their trust. They trusted, and you delivered them. They cried to you, and you saved them. In you they trusted, and were not disappointed. I am alone and not a man, scorned by men and despised by the people. All who see me mock, they hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you, even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me, roaring lions carrying their prey open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is turned to wax. It melts away within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You have laid me in the dust of the dead. Dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men have encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. But you, O Lord, do not fall off. O my strength, come quickly to my help. Deliver my life from the sword, my precious life with the power of the dog. Rescue me from the mouths of the lion. Save me from the horn of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for him. Verse 25. From you comes the king of my praise and the great assembly. Before those who fear you will I fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. They will seek the Lord and praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over all the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before them. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, prosperity, will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord, and they will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn. For he has done it. So, this young body and see what makes this song such an amazing, wonderful, awesome song. First of all, notice the prophecy of the cross. The prophecy of the cross. There are many reasons I believe the Bible is true. Many reasons I place my faith in Jesus. I believe in God. But one very important reason is how the Bible contains hundreds and hundreds of prophecies concerning many things, but particularly concerning Jesus Christ, his birth, his life, his death, his crucifixion, his resurrection, and every one of them has either come true, the ones about his life or death, has come again, they're going to be true. But we see so many prophecies that are given in extreme detail, and then they are fulfilled. Psalm 22 was written about 800 years before the life of Christ. And yet in this psalm, we see prophecy after prophecy after prophecy concerning Jesus being fulfilled. I'm just going to refer to six of them. There are dozens of prophecies in this one psalm. Let me just briefly this morning refer to six. First of all, the words of Jesus on the cross are prophesied. The words of Jesus on the cross are prophesied. Verse 1, the psalmist starts right off. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? The psalmist, David, wrote these words 800 years before the crucifixion. And even when we turn to the Gospels in the Matthew 27, verse 46, the Gospel writer is giving a description of what took place at Calvary when Jesus was crucified. And he said, about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Exactly what David spoke concerning Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, the Spirit. That's just one. How about, secondly, the life condition while Jesus was on the cross, the life condition. I know you talk about life in churches and everything. What about the life condition? Well, look on your passage, Psalm 22 and verse 2. It says, oh my God, I cried out by day, but you did not answer. By night, and I am not silent. He said, I cried in the daylight. You didn't answer me, sir. So remove me from the cross. Yes, I cried at night, in the darkness of night. There's nothing but silence from God. So does that mean Jesus is on the cross all day and into the night? No, that's not what it means. Because when you look at Matthew 27, verse 45, it says, from the noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came all over the land. Jesus was on the cross at 9, what we call 9 in the morning. 3 hours, it was daylight, like any Sunday morning. And Jesus cried unto the Lord, God, and his Father was silent. At 12 o'clock, darkness, black as night, came over the land for 3 hours. And there was darkness. Exactly what the psalmist said. In the light of day and the dark of night, Jesus cried out unto the Father as he was on the cross. By the way, if Jesus was on the cross and it was daylight from 3 to 12, and it would turn dark at 12, and to stay that way until Jesus died at 3, now ask the first congregation how many hours that was. Only one person answered. We didn't answer. We're going to see if the second congregation goes. How long was Jesus on the cross if he went on at 9 and came off at 3? What? 6. 6 hours, right? He was on the cross 6 hours. You know, in Scripture, numbers often are symbolic. The number 6 is often used in the Bible as a symbolic number for man. When Jesus was on the cross, he was dying for the sins of man, and that fully taking the sin of death upon himself. So there's a life condition. Jesus is on the cross. One of those details that the Scripture is perfectly accurate in describing. Then number 3, about the insult against Jesus. Well, Jesus is on the cross. The insult that were hurled against Jesus while he was on the cross. Psalm 22, verse 7 and 8. David wrote, "All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, but the Lord rescues him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in the Lord." David prophesied that there would be this person that was insulted, they were mocked, and they were ridiculed. When we turn to Matthew 27, Matthew is writing of what took place as he watched it took place. He said, "Those who passed by, who hurled insults at them, shaking their heads and saying, 'You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God.'" Now, you see, there's some things that David spoke of and some prophecies in the scripture. You say, well, maybe Jesus knew Psalm 22. Absolutely, Jesus knew Psalm 22. And maybe Jesus spoke then while he was on the cross, like, my God, forsake me. He was quoting scripture or something. And you say, maybe you could try to explain that away by saying Jesus knew the scripture and he just quoted scripture. But how can you explain the enemies of God fulfilling the scripture? I mean, they certainly won't to intentionally fulfill the scripture. If anything, they would want to try to avoid fulfilling the scripture. But here it says that they hurled insults just as they 800 years before said they would do it. And number four, the thirst of Jesus on the cross is prophesied. The thirstiness of Jesus on the cross is prophesied. When you look down in verse 15, where he talks about being thirsty, and he says in chapter 22, verse 15, he says, "My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth." You ever been so thirsty that it's like you can't even move your tongue, and it's just like dry cotton? Because that was the condition of this one that the psalmist is describing. And then in John 19, verse 28, as John speaks and describes of what's taking place on the cross, he said, "Later, knowing that everything had been finished and the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, 'I'm thirsty.'" I thirst. From the cross, the words of Jesus, the condition of Jesus, his thirstiness, was perfectly predicted and prophesied by David 800 years before Jesus ever hung on the cross. And then number five, the gambling. While Jesus was on the cross, is prophesied. The gambling is prophesied. Psalm 22, verse 18, "And he divided my garments among them, and they cast lots for my clothing." And that was interesting, that David would write about this individual that he's talking about. He said they gambled for his clothing, they cast lots for those things that he wore. But yet, when we read of what took place when Jesus was on the cross, in Matthew 37, verse 35, "And when they had crucified Jesus, they divided up his clothes by casting lots." What an amazing detail. Detail after detail. One more, very important detail. The piercing of Jesus' hands and feet are prophesied. The piercing of the hands and Jesus' feet. And when you talk about the piercing, it's not talking about getting your ears pierced, your nose pierced, your belly button pierced, or some other part of your body pierced. It's talking about the driving of nails into the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. And it says his hands and his feet were pierced. And an interesting thing about it is we said that David wrote 800 years before Jesus. But when David wrote, the form of punishment of crucifixion was not known. It was not even practiced. Most commentators and historians will say that crucifixion didn't start until much, much later, and that the Romans, in the time of Jesus, were the first ones to actually use spikes into the hands or the feet while crucifying Jesus. So how could David, who was writing 800 years before the use of crucifixion through the hands and the feet, know to write of the piercing of the hands and the feet? No man can do that, absolutely. But the Spirit of God can. If he carried along David and inspired him to write the accuracy, the total accuracy of the scripture. And so, when you look in the Bible, in Luke 24, verse 39, after the resurrection, Jesus appeared to his disciples, And he says, look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and blood, as you see that I have. Jesus and blood. They cannot believe. They still cannot believe that Jesus was alive. And said, Jesus, is it really you? So look at my hands. See the scars. Look at my feet. See the scars. It's me. I've risen from the dead. Exactly what David had said in Psalm 22. He said, fulfilled even in the details of the scars in his hands and feet. So those are the prophecies concerning the cross. Just a few of them in Psalm 22. Now look at, secondly, the person on the cross. The person on the cross, Psalm 22, verse 6. I am a worm and not even a man. Scorned by men and despised by people. I'm a worm. I'm so low, I'm not even as a man. See, Jesus was so low in his death, in his humbling of himself, that he became even as a lowly worm. He said, I'm a worm. It's an amazing thing to think of. Someone said, great is the mystery that God became a man. And even greater still is the mystery that this man became a lamb. And even greater still that this lamb became a worm. Just a worm. Jesus was a worm. You say, how is he a worm? Well, he was so low. He offered himself up so completely that he gave himself willingly to the humiliation and the shame of sin to die on the cross. I believe I heard first time the great pastor Adrian Rogers say, you know, if you step on the snow, he'll strike back. But if you step on the worm, it's just crushed. Jesus was a worm. When he offered himself up for our sins, he didn't strike back. He just gave himself on the cross to die. In Isaiah 53, verse 4, it says, surely he is born out of infirmity and carried our sorrow. Yet we considered him stricken, smitten by God. He was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed by our iniquities. Just a word. Another interesting thing about that description of this person on the cross as a worm. The worm, the word for worm is tola, T-O-L-A. And scholars tell us that there was a specific worm, there was a crimson worm, that when it was crushed, it would exude this crimson, this red slime material. And that crushing of this worm would be used in producing a red or a crimson dye. You remember in the description of the tabernacle, in Exodus 26, where God gave instructions for the tabernacle and how to approach God, and just before the priest would enter the Holy of Holies to the into the presence of very God in order to offer sacrifices on behalf of the people, there was a veil or a curtain, and there were threads, there were crimson threads, tola, from the worm that were woven into that curtain. A reminder of you have to pass through the blood of the Messiah to come into the presence of God. In Isaiah 1 verse 18, the scripture says, come now and let us reason together. Though your sins are as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. You want to do it? With that Hebrew word right there, it is for scarlet. The same word that he won the cross to say, I am but a worm. I am scarlet. You see, when Jesus is just a worm, a took on our sin, though you are as scarlet, the sin dressed scarlet, they said he's white. He became sin for us. He's just a worm dying, not striking back, but being crushed. And he was crushed, his blood flowed out, and that blood purifies and that blood cleanses, makes us white as snow. All the guilt of sin is made white as snow. The person of God, the one who died for us. And then I want you to see the perpetrator of the cross. The perpetrator. You know, many times people say, well, who killed Jesus? Who put Jesus on the cross? And when we look at Psalm 22, beginning in the last phrase of verse 15, it says, you laid me in the dust of death. Dogs have surrounded me, an assembly of evil men have encircled me, for they have pierced my hands and my feet. They have pierced my hands and my feet. Who's he talking about? The they that have pierced his hands and feet. Well, let's look at it kind of the reverse order that the scripture puts it. First of all, in the outline, the Jewish religious leaders put Jesus to death on the cross. They persecuted him. Notice the passage says, the assembly of the wicked have encompassed me. They have pierced my hands. The assembly of the wicked. Who is the assembly of the wicked that he's talking about here? Well, if you look out at that passage in Matthew 26, verse 57 and 59, you'll see that after Jesus was betrayed by Judas, Jesus remember, was arrested, and then he was brought before, as that passage says, the assembly of the religious leaders. Remember, there's this group of religious leaders that was made up of various of the Jewish religious leaders, and they were the assembly of the wicked, because they didn't believe Jesus. They believed he was a blasphemer of God. You know what? After they assembled and they met and they said he was worthy of death because he had blasphemed God, claiming to be God. They did not believe him. They were the assembly of wicked. So this assembly of Jewish religious leaders put Jesus to death. But not only that, if you look at the next few verses there in Matthew 26, verse 66 and 67, says this assembly of the wicked religious Jewish leaders influenced the Jewish people to call for the crucifixion of Jesus, their Messiah. Remember, they got Jesus before the crowd, and Pilate says, no, can I release Barabbas instead? Because there's nothing wrong with this when Jesus and this group of assembly of religious leaders egged the crowd on to call for the crucifixion of Jesus. So who were the perpetrators of the death of Jesus? This assembly of the Jewish religious leaders. But not only that, the unbelieving Gentiles were the perpetrators of the cross. Do you notice in our passage in Psalm 22, verse 16, it says, dogs have surrounded me. Dogs. You're not talking about four-legged creatures. You're talking about the two-legged kind. It may surprise you that oftentimes unbelieving Gentiles in the scriptures are called dogs. There are many reasons for that. We don't have time to go on that. I just put a couple of references out of Matthew 15, verse 21, and then Philippians 3, verse 2. But one example is in the book of the Revelation, Revelation 22, verse 15. And it's talking about those that come into eternal life, those that are not eternal life. And it said, outside of the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. So it says there are these Gentile unbelievers that put Jesus on the cross, the Roman soldiers that did not believe, the Roman government that did not believe he was the Messiah. You know, Pilate, even though Herod can find anything wrong with him, said he really doesn't deserve death, but we'll put him over to death just to appease the people. They did not believe he was who he claimed to be. But by extension, it was just not the unbelieving Gentiles, it was all the unbelievers of all the world. Because when Jesus died on the cross, he took the sins of the whole world upon himself. So who were the perpetrators of the cross? It was the religious Jewish leaders who believed in God. It was the unbelieving Gentiles, but there's another who put Jesus on the cross, and that is God. God put Jesus on the cross. Do you notice that in our passage in Psalm 22, the last part of verse 15? It says, for you have laid me in the dust of death. You, again, King James says, thou has laid me in the dust of death. Thou who? Who laid him in the dust of death? Talk about God. God laid Jesus in the dust of death. Isaiah 53, verse 10 is right now. For it was the Lord's will to crush him, and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, this is the plan of God, that the Son, Jesus Christ, would be put to death on the cross. It's not an accident. Things are not out of control, but it is in the purpose plan of God, the perpetrator of the cross. Those who put Jesus to death were the religious leaders, the wicked religious leaders, the unbelieving Gentiles, and even God himself. But now, let's look at another thing. Let's look at the pain of the cross. The pain of the cross. We can't spend a lot of time on this. We talked about it, particularly in the Wednesday night service this past week, as we went through the day-by-day experiences and the week leading up to the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But just briefly, let me remind you of how Jesus suffered on the cross. Number one, he suffered physically. He suffered physically. We know that. We know, and we've heard many times the description of Jesus suffering on the cross and leading up to his death. We know that he was beaten. He was flogged. The torturers that tortured Jesus in the flogging before he ever got to the cross were expert torturers. They were pro torturers. They were so expert in what they did of their torture, their point was not to kill the person that they were beating and whipping, but to bring him so near death that he would be beaten and maimed so badly that oftentimes someone had been whipped by the Roman torture could not even be recognized as who they were. And that is likely what was taking place with Jesus. And then he, from there, went to the cross. And he hung on the cross and suffered on the cross this excruciating death. The word excruciating was a word that even had to be made up and developed to describe the suffering of one on the cross. Excruciating means out of the cross or out of crucifixion. It is describing a pain and a suffering that's only experienced through the cross. Jesus suffered physically, but not only did he suffer physically, he suffered emotionally. He suffered emotionally in his giving his life for us. He was mocked. We talked about how he was abused. He hung naked and shamed on the cross. And can you imagine the pure, holy Son of God being shamed and ridiculed as emotional pain he suffered? And then he suffered spiritually. He suffered spiritually. It's hard for us to even fully grasp, I don't think we can, how Jesus, the perfect Son of God, who knew no sin, not even a glimmer of him, a touch of sin, took our sin upon himself and became sin for us. And even in that passage that we read out of verse 1 of Psalm 22, where it says, "By God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The Son of God, God the Father, separated by our sin. So he suffered physically, he suffered emotionally, and he suffered spiritually. Many people have been crucified through the years by the Romans, but nobody suffered like Jesus. To the extent and to the death of Jesus, because nobody was doing what Jesus did and taking our sin upon himself and making the payment for our salvation. So Jesus suffered physically, emotionally, and spiritually, and then on the back of your outline, Jesus suffered from three primary sources. He suffered from God. He suffered from God. The Bible tells us in the psalm here, tells us that God brought him to the dust of death, that God poured out the wrath or his wrath against sin upon Jesus. The wrath of God was poured out upon him. So he suffered from God. He suffered from men. We already talked about how the men beat him. They ridiculed him. They mocked him. He suffered from God. He suffered from men. And he suffered from Satan. He suffered from Satan. Verse 13, verse 21 of Psalm 22, the psalmist wrote, said, "The lions have encircled me." The lions. Remember, in the New Testament, it says, "The devil is like a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour." The New Testament, when Judas betrayed Jesus, the scripture says that this was Satan's hour. devil thought that he could stop the Messiah, the salvation work of Jesus Christ, by putting him to death. But actually, he was walking in the plan of God and providing the means of salvation for mankind. But yet, Jesus suffered at the hands of Satan. No one has ever suffered like Jesus. And Jesus, the infinite God, experienced in finite time what finite man will experience in the infinite eternity apart from God. Can we comprehend how that happened? How the suffering came upon Jesus, the infinite God, in this finite 6 hours, like man will suffer for sin if he receives Jesus in the infinite time of eternity. No one suffered like Jesus. There was a pain of Jesus. But then, hallelujah, number five, the praise that comes as a result of the cross. The praise that comes as a result of the cross. You've been reading the Psalm 22, and you see the gloom, you see the sadness, you see the despair, the pain, the suffering. And when you come down to verse 22, and there's just like that shift. A change in the tone, change in the atmosphere, change in the perspective. Says, I will praise your name to my brother. In the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he, who is he? He is God. God has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. Who's the afflicted one? It's the one on the cross, the one that's suffering. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. What are you talking about here? He says, this one that was afflicted, this one that was ridiculed, this one that suffered in so many ways, then something happens to where he becomes the praise and the center of all praise and all worship. What happened where that says, he heard my cry, God heard my cry, and he came to my help? What happened in that? That was the resurrection. That was the resurrection of Christ. And it says, why does he say, he has not disdained my suffering? He has not forsaken my sorrow? How do we know that God the Father did not forsake what Jesus did? How do we know that God the Father accepted the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross? From the grave he arose. And he's seated at the right hand of God the Father. And he's ever making intercession for us. And so we see the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We see that God, while Jesus was suffering, kept silent because the work needed to be finished. But when the work on the cross was finished, God raised Jesus from his grave and affirmed that what Jesus did was acceptable to God the Father. But you notice what it says here, all praise breaks loose because of the resurrection. All praise breaks loose because of what Jesus Christ has done and who God the Father is in the plan of our salvation. And do you notice where the praise is centered? Is in the assembly, not of the wicked, in the assembly of the saints. In the assembly of those who fear the Lord and fear God. See, there's an awesome, wonderful thing when the saints of God, when the people of God, come together and assemble together to praise and worship God Almighty. You know, we worship on Sundays. One of the reasons we worship on Sundays is because the resurrection happened on Sunday. And every Sunday is resurrection Sunday for the believer. And we can worship God in many places, but it's a special thing when we come together and praise God and worship together. You notice in that passage, it says, I, speaking to one who went through all the affliction, will praise with my brother. I will praise you. When you sing worship unto God, Jesus is singing with you. You know that? We're singing to him, praising him, but he's praising with us. When I preach and talk about Jesus and the glory and the salvation that he's provided for, Jesus is speaking through me. He's preaching. You know, sometimes you can be in church can be filled with people, and I can be speaking, sharing the truth and the Word of God, and it feels like you're the only one here. It feels like God's speaking directly to you. Jesus is preaching. He's speaking. So when we come together, Jesus is here. He's here to receive our worship and our praise, but he's also to join in with our praise. He inhabits the praise. You think, well, I can spend a month of Sundays just talking about that, how wonderful that is. Let's move on. Number six, the provision from the one who died on the cross. The provision Psalm 22, verse 26, the poor will even be satisfied. They who seek the Lord will praise him. May your heart live forever. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Somebody in relation to this Savior that was afflicted, who suffered, who was buried, and rose again. The poor will eat. Who is the poor? Now, some commentators believe it's talking about people who are poor. A little bit later, talking about people who are rich, that Jesus came for the rich and the poor, for all different types of people. But I think there's a different emphasis in here. It could apply to that. But I think it's a different emphasis here. I think it's talking about those who realize their spiritual poverty. They have nothing to bring before God. They say, you know, I'm not worthy of God. I'm a sinner. And so, if I'm saved, it's only by the grace of God, which is all by condition, right? None of us can bring anything to offer before him. It's only by his grace. And so, in Matthew 5, verse 3, it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, that they will be filled. The poor, when they look to Jesus, will see the resurrected Savior, and they will be satisfied with the spirit. What a wonderful passage of the Lord. The proclamation of the cross. The proclamation of the cross. You see it there? In the last two verses, there's so much more. But in the last two verses of Psalm 22, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, for he has done it. What did he do? He died for our sins. He was buried, and he rose from the grave, conquering sin and death. You know, I love it. Most people like a little bit of recognition when they're in the Scripture. You know you're in the Scripture. The Scripture talks about you. It talks about you in several places. It's in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that you are, that he gave his only begotten Son, that if you believe in him, you should not perish, but have everlasting life. But here you are in Psalm 22, when it says that this gospel of a suffering Savior, of a resurrected Lord, will be proclaimed to people not yet even born. 800 years before Christ, the suffering Savior would be proclaimed. After Jesus actually suffered, died, and rose, Jesus would be proclaimed. Listen, if you're saved, you're saved because somebody proclaimed the gospel to you. Somebody told you about the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and the resurrection. There you are in the Scripture. You heard, you believed, you received the everlasting life. Listen, if you're a believer, not only has somebody proclaimed to you the gospel, but now you have the great joy and privilege of proclaiming the gospel to somebody else. Listen, we live in a world that's lost without Jesus. We see evidence of it more and more every day. Our world needs Jesus, right? And we who know him know the gospel that Jesus died for our sins, not just for the up and out people, but the down and out, all people, the down and out. And we need to let them know that if they would believe upon him, Jesus will save their soul, transform their life, fill them with the joy and the peace of knowing Jesus Christ, and they can join us eternally as the brothers and sisters in eternal heaven. You know Jesus Christ. Just follow us together. Lord God, I thank you that you have done for us what we could not do for ourselves. You provide for our salvation. And that it's that great love of God that has provided for us eternal life. And we rejoice in you today. It's in the name we pray. Amen. If you've never received Jesus Christ, we encourage you this morning to receive him. Let's stand together as we sing. Thank you. Father God, thank you that you in love lift us who cannot do for ourselves, but because of what you have done in the resurrection, we can live in a wonderful, awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Attention all for God, and all the winds fast around. Extend the mightiest pieces, and rose at every sound. As in hopeless sorrow, as in fear today, which find the soldiers breaking through, to the other fall away. Then just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gates began to rattle, and the voice began to call. I hurried to the window, and looked down into the street. Between swords and torches, and the sound of soldiers beat. But there was no one there to carry, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me, as she told us where she did. They moved in the night, and none of us know where. Oh, the stones can roll away, and now everybody is there. So we both ran through the garden, then John ran on ahead. And we found the stone, and emptied it just the way the fairy said. The binding sheet they wrapped it in was just as it reached down. And how aware they take it. More than that, there was something strange about the thing. Just people did not know. You couldn't believe the miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation. The moon is very high. It was seen and crucified. Inside the hospital, the girl's name was changed. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied and knew his name. So even if it wasn't, in my confusion, disappeared in sleep. And every fear I'd ever had, just fell into peace. Thank you. Thank you.